The and I think it's spot on because we had the Hugo de Stoop from Euronav on recently, and he had the same point. Like he's trying to make the tanker company green, but suddenly you can't get financing on the same level as others. So he's saying, do you think it's going to be easier for that transition or harder? Maybe that just emphasizes your point, but I thought you talked a bit about the report, and we're going to talk a lot about that today, but maybe just start off with what do you think is the hardest part to predict in finance in general? Is there anything that is super complicated to predict, or is it just a whole spectrum that is kind of hard to predict?
Reversing the question, saying what's the easiest part is predict central banks and governments. They're only always going to decrease the price of money. They are willing to live with the unintended consequences in terms of inequality and the likes, despite perfect academic evidence that is wrong. What is very difficult to predict is energy. I think, and energy to me is the single biggest impulse and input to an economic predictive model. Because there's such a big swing factors. Most recession starts with an energy crisis. Most bust a boom cycle starts with very low energy. And I think to a large extent, energy drives the price of money, not money, price of money driving energy. But of course, now, as we just talked about, there's of course a feedback loop, as this gentleman was also alluding to, that the marginal cost of energy and mining is increasing because of limitation from regulative and ESG concerns. But I, to be honest, nothing is easy to predict. I can't even predict my wife's purchasing power and spend. So I don't think the way to approach the predictive question is to assume that you can predict anything. You can look for policy response into a context of history. And again, I think our game, your game, anyone who wants to be educated in this needs to think like a bookmaker. What is the probability? What's the long shot? What is the even odds of what goes on? And then you say, and I think Torres says this the best. He says the deals or the trade you need to do is not every single trade that you think has momentum or intrinsic value. The best trades to make is when there is a massive gap between the perception of the value and the reality of the value. So, we use just now the ESG lobby, which is growing at 35% a year in terms of asset under management. That doesn't ring any. I mean, that's a huge gap between perception and reality. There isn't something called ESG. It's a label. It's a very good initiative, and ultimately it would be a good thing. But most companies can be ES or G. They can't be ESG, as your shipping man was trying to indicate. So for me, the gap between perception and reality is the trade that you need to find as a macro guy, but also as a politically and socially conscious persons. I think the biggest gap in history is the gap there is in age between you and me right now. The spread between poor and rich is closing in because of the subsidy that we do and the good work we're trying to do with the lower income brackets. But the ability of young people to catch on to the revenue stream that we baby boomers has been given is very limited, and that sets up immediately the reason why blockchain and NFTs and of course cryptocurrency overall becomes attractive, because the young people, and I assume to some extent, and not giving you words in your mouth that you don't stand by, but I think young people feels that this crypto blockchain space is somewhere where you can catch on to that wealth that we have generated for ourselves, which pretty much has been driven by ever lower interest rate and lower in inflation. So from that perspective, I think that's how the story really evolves.